In this video, we're going to talk about how you can save off your results from the simulation into a data file. Let's get to it. This video is going to be in addition to the last video we did, the last tutorial where we did a simple orbit. We're just going to add an extra step in here for the data file. So if you haven't seen that other video, I'll put a link in the description or throw something on the end card so you can go check it out. Basically, in that video, we started first by making a spacecraft and adjusting its properties. Then in steps 3 through 5, we adjusted the spacecraft's orbit. Steps 6 through 9, we updated or changed some of the values of the propagator. And then in step 10, we modified some of the outputs for like the orbit viewer and the ground track plot. And then in steps 11 through 16, we updated the mission sequence. So in this video, the extra steps that we're going to add in is going to be right here, right after step 10. And actually what we're doing essentially is we're going to add one more output to that step 10. And that output's going to be the data file. All right, so the first step is we are going to add a report file output item. So there on the left tree, you'll see the folder that says output. You're going to want to right click on that, and in the menu that pops up, you need to find and click on the item that says report file. When you do that, you'll notice that another item is added to the output folder. You can see it here on the right. It's called report file 1. In the next step, we're going to go ahead and rename the report file object. So go right click on that report file. In the menu that pops up, look for and select the item that says rename. And that's going to pop up a little window where you can type in the new name and click OK. As you can see here on the right, that changed the name from report file 1 to simple orbit results. This is really nice because if you have multiple files that you want to record with different variables or different names, you can keep track of the different reports that are going to be written. And of course, the file naming convention, the name needs to start with a letter, and then it can have letters, digits, and underscores. No spaces or no weird symbols or anything like that. And you can't do any of the keywords or the commands or any of those special names that GMAT has reserved, but it'll pop up a warning and tell you whether your file name is valid or not. Now that we've renamed the file, we're going to go ahead and double click on it to open the edit window. There we can adjust all the properties and options to adjust the report file to be written the way we want it to. You'll notice there's 3 general areas of this edit window. There's this box to the left that has all of the file formatting options. There's a big box to the right that has all of the file content options, right? What are you trying to save to the file? And then down at the bottom, you have the file save option. And we're going to go over each of these real quick. So let's go ahead and start with updating the file format options. You'll notice there's a few options here on the left. The first one says write report. I really like this one here because it gives you an option to either turn on or turn off this report object without having to like delete it and then recreate it. The next one underneath it says write headers. As you can see, I've got 2 different generated data files here on the right. One of them has headers, which is just the first row with a bunch of names of what each column is. And the second file doesn't have a header. The checkbox underneath it says left justified. One of the files has it left justified, and so you can see all of the numbers lining up there to the left, even with the negative sign in that second column, versus this other file here where it's not left justified. It says it's supposed to be middle justified, but when you actually save out to the data file, it looks more like it's right justified, so it kind of lines up on that right side there. Zero fill is going to add zeros in to make the number that's reported have the precision that you specified down below that we'll talk about here in a sec. But you can kind of see it right here in these 2 data files. Right up here, it added 2 zeros to fill in that first data point in the second column so that it had the 10 digits that we specified for precision. And this other file here does not fill in the zeros to make sure that we have the correct precision. And of course, precision is just the number of digits that gets reported to the file. Now, it's not the number of decimal places, it's just the total number of digits. The last checkbox is for fixed width. There's 2 general formats of these data files. You can either have it fixed width or not fixed width. So these 2 data files that I have here are actually fixed width, and you can kind of see each column. If you look at it, it's got the same number of places, whether it has a number there or not, right? That's why it's fixed width. And that's what that column width value is there on the bottom left. You can change how wide these columns are. The other option is if you click this fixed width off, then you can go and adjust the delimiter there to tell you what symbol you want to place between the columns, right? Space, tab, comma. And as you can see by this other data file that I put up right here, you'll notice that it doesn't really have columns. It's just all slammed to the left, taking out any spaces or white space. And you'll see that I used the comma as a delimiter. So the commas just specify where one column stops and the next one begins. Now the last one on here is the solver iterations. So there's a way to use this software so that you can run through different scenarios to try and optimize your mission. So if you were trying to run an optimization sequence, you know, you might have 10 different runs. You change it just a little bit and you see, was it better? Was it worse? And then hopefully by the end of those 10 runs, you settle in on what that final value is. And so this option here to change the solver iterations is telling GMAT which one of those iterations you want to save to a file. So you can either specify you want them all saved to the file, you want the current run saved, or you want the final run saved. Now, since we're running this one at a time, just go ahead and leave that at current. When we get to like an optimization problem, we might play with this a little bit and show you what it does. All right, so let's go ahead and hop over to the file contents and we're going to adjust those options. So you can see right here in that box on the top what would be written to the report. When you click edit, a window will pop up that gives you options on how to select the variable and add it to the file. First, you want to select what object that the variable belongs to, right? You don't want to just tell it the angular velocity, because is that the angular velocity of your spacecraft around the Earth, or is that the angular velocity of the Earth around the Sun, right? So you want to specify what object the variable corresponds to. And then when you select that object here on the second column, you can scroll through all the properties or parameters available for that object. So go ahead and click what you want to be added to the report file. Now, some of these variables actually have another option that you need to specify. So if you look underneath this object properties scrolling box, you'll notice something that says central body and like a drop-down list. If the parameter you selected requires additional input, you'll see that this will pop up. So for example, if I, like I show here, chose that I wanted to record the radius of periapsis, then this extra option box appears underneath it that says central body, and if I click it open, it shows me a list of all of my different options. So let me try and explain why some of the arguments require additional input with an example. Let's say that I'm doing a flyby mission past the moon, right? I'm orbiting the Earth, but I'm doing a flyby where I get pretty close to the moon, and I want to find out how close to the moon I get. Well, what I could do is I could select this radius of periapsis of the spacecraft. Now, if I did it around the Earth, that's going to be how close I get to the Earth in the orbit, but that's not what I want to know. I want to know how close to the moon do I get in my flyby orbit. So what I could do is I could do radius of periapsis and then find the moon in this list of central bodies, right? It's actually named Luna. It's at the bottom. So if I click that, then this will actually tell me how close I get to the moon, right? It's the radius of periapsis to the moon. And so when I look at the report file, I can kind of go and find the smallest value, and that's the closest I get to the moon. Some of the other things that will pop up will be like what coordinate frame you want to use, stuff like that. So after you've selected your variable and potentially selected what variable option you want from the additional box at the bottom, then you need to use these right and left arrows to add that item to the selection box here on the right. You actually have a few different options there with those buttons. You've got up and down, which just moves the variable up and down in the list, so you can order your variables the way you want them. Then you have those middle left and right arrows that either add something to that selected box or takes it off. And then the two arrows on the bottom will add everything to the report file or take everything off of the report file. So take a minute and try and find all the parameters you want in the list, and then use the right arrow to add them to the selected values here on the right. Those selected values are what's going to be included in the report. And when you're done with that, go ahead and click OK. Now, before we move on, I want to show you something pretty cool. If you change the object type from spacecraft to space point, it gives you an object list so that you can maybe record the data of some of the other objects in the solar system, right? Maybe you want to look at what's Jupiter doing. The last thing we need to go over of this window is the file save options. These are pretty straightforward. You can either type in the file name you want here in that edit text box on the left. This will save to the default location. I really don't like doing that because sometimes you don't have access to the default location if like you're on a shared computer or it's buried somewhere and you have to try and go find it. What I would rather do is hit the browse button here on the right. When you do that, it will open up a file explorer window where you can browse for the exact folder where you want to put it and write in the name here on the bottom and click open. And that will add the entire path to this file name here on the left. You could have just typed in the path and the file name as well if you had it somewhere, or maybe you could copy paste it from something. So go ahead and adjust the name of the file and the folder that it's in, then click OK. All right, so we went ahead and added a report file object and adjusted its properties. And so now we are ready to go ahead and run the simulation. Now you have to actually run a simulation for it to record values to the report object that you made. It doesn't just make it when you make the object and click OK, you have to actually run a simulation. So go ahead and click the play button right here to run a simulation. When the simulation is done running, then you can open up the report file and look at all of your data. All right, I'm going to go ahead and end the video here. You know what to do. Like, comment, subscribe. I'll see you in the next video.